Hey Trekland, Star Trek Las Vegas is almost over, but I did want to take a moment and share with you a visit with somebody who's new to Star Trek Las Vegas this year, but not new to you, not new to Star Trek, and certainly not to the Star Trek literary world. It's New York Times best-selling author, David Mack.
Hey, Trek fans, great to see you.
Good. How has your Vegas been, David?
What a blast. It has been an incredible week of panels revealing the cover of my new Discovery novel, Desperate Hours, coming on September 26th. I've gotten to talk to a lot of my favorite Trek personalities, like Nicole DeBoer, and I got today to do something that was very special to me. I got to thank Ira Stephen Bear, former DS9 showrunner, for helping to launch my Star Trek writing career 22 years ago today, when the break session for my first episode, Starship Down, started in the LA offices. When John Ordover and I went out, we're in the writer's room. I caught up with him just a few minutes ago, and I was able to thank him for all he's done for me. He didn't realize how much he had done for me. And he said to me, it's always a pleasure. He said he's affected enough people's lives for the worst that it was nice to be thanked by someone whose life he has changed for the better.
And that's a very Ira-esque thing to say.
But it meant a lot to me to thank Ira. I think it's important that creators thank the people who help them find their way down the creative path. And Ira was someone whose trust in me as a screenwriter who had no previous credits helped begin my career. And it meant a lot to me to be able to thank him in person.
And you had Starship Down and you had...
It's Only a Paper Moon in season 7.
Right. Another classic that has affected a lot of people. Well, it's been quite a path since then. How many books?
I've written about 27 Star Trek novels. I've written about 30 some odd novels, maybe 33 or 36 altogether. I've got the Discovery novel in September, a Star Trek Titan novel in November, and coming in January 2018, my first, well, not my first original novel, but the first novel in my new original series, Dark Arts. The book is called The Midnight Front, and it's World War II with black magicians dealing demonic magic behind the scenes of the war. So that's going to be a big, fun war epic thriller.
So it's the war, on the surface, it's the war we knew.
Yes, but there was a secret war going on behind the scenes. The Nazis had occult sorcerers working for them, so Churchill decided the Allies needed black magicians working for the Allies, so they convened a special magical warfare group called the Midnight Front.
Wow. And that's your own baby.
That's my own baby, something I concocted out of thin air. I'm writing the sequel right now for Tor Books. The sequel is called The Iron Codex, and it's a 1954 Cold War spy thriller involving nuclear arms race and a black magic arms race happening in tandem. And the plan is for book 3, which is already under contract at Tor, called The Shadow Commission, is going to take place in 1963, right after the Kennedy assassination, and it's going to be a conspiracy thriller about the governments of the world turning against the magicians who they've been secretly employing for 2 decades.
Oh, okay. Another one of that vibe of are they with us or are they against us?
You got it.
Right, right, right. Well, this is awesome. So, I take just a second to talk about getting the honor and also the thrill and maybe the pressure of doing that first Discovery book.
Being asked to write the first Discovery book was both an honor, but it's a little scary. At the time that I was asked to start work, they had not settled on what the pilot episode was going to be. They hadn't completely settled what the backstory of the main character was. The first two ideas we had for the book had to be thrown away after some development had been done, because the ideas behind the scenes were always in flux, always changing. But
well, that's the beauty of being in it early, but also the curse
of
being in it.
The risk of being in it early.
Right, right, yeah.
But it was a testament to the faith that Kirsten Beyer had in me and that my editors had in me, that they knew that I could keep up with the shifting sands under my feet. And eventually we found something that did work for all of us, that we're all very proud of. I like to think, and it's my hope that readers will agree, I think Desperate Hours is the most Star Trek-y thing I have written in a lot of years for the Star Trek line. It's about hope, it's about forgiveness, it's about teamwork, And it's about solving problems through science and through understanding and not just through strength or through politics.
Because you've written for all the other series?
I've written for pretty much every iteration of Star Trek there is, every incarnation,
right.
Both literary original and TV original. So this was just the continuation of that.
Right. Well, that's saying much. That's saying a lot if you're thinking this is the... if you're feeling that this is the most Star Trek-y novel mm-hmm. that you've done in the line. That's awesome. Well, good. I the last thing has to be the whole new paradigm of the way comics and novels will be treated with Discovery. It's like we really are in 2017, right?
Really?
As far as feeding into the... They won't be the ancillary knock. I mean, explain that, because that was a big good news item.
Okay, first, I just want to make sure before anybody gets the wrong idea, we are not saying that the books and comics are canon. We are not saying
that.
What we are saying is that we are working hard behind the scenes to tell well-integrated stories in print form, in both prose and in comics, mm-hmm. that are going to line up with the creative vision of the team in the writer's room. And the writer's room is showing us an unprecedented level of access and respect in trying to make sure that they don't step on what we're doing once they've approved it. That's not to guarantee that it won't ever happen, but they are at least making more of an effort than has ever been made before, and I feel very honored and respected, and it makes me feel like part of the team, that they are willing to go that extra mile to work with us and not treat us like the tail on the dog.
Right, right. And I missed seeing Kirsten this weekend, but that she's kind of the nexus of that.
She is. She's my point. She's my point person in the room. She acts as the official liaison between the TV show and the print arm, all the tie-in fiction, really, whether it's comics or books. When I have a question, I go through Kirsten. When notes have to come to me, they go through Kirsten. And also, they are allowing me to have feedback on the show.
I was going to say, you're getting to when I get there.
Yeah, so when I get the scripts, I get to say, hey, you know, I think I may have spotted something that could be a problem or might butt up against canon. And so my orders are, when I find something like that, I send it to Kirsten. Mm-hmm. If Kirsten thinks the note is valid, she takes it into the room. And sometimes it gets fixed. Sometimes they have valid creative reasons for why they want to override that. But they at least allow two-way communication. It's not like the old days when it was all fiat down from the mountain.
Right.
Now we're allowed to communicate.
Or the Berlin Wall.
Or the Berlin Wall. Now it's a two-way communication. And again, that's just an honor that I'm trying not to abuse.
Right. Well, it's a huge step forward. And for all the fans that didn't understand, oh, it's Hollywood and it's rights and it's money and it's credit and all of that. And guilds and things. And to find the way to make that work in a great Star Trek way, and kind of reflect the modern way of things evolving. I mean, the streaming service is a mix of TV and video and movies.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it's a whole new world and getting out of the old paradigms and the old boxes.
They are really getting out of the old paradigm. This is going to be not just a new Star Trek series, it's going to be a new kind of Star mm-hmm. Trek series. This is Star Trek for the modern golden age of television. It's going to be suited to its format. And it's going to have that serialized storytelling that audiences have come to expect from premium dramatic television.
Right. And it's going to be right there with all the big boys.
Hopefully it's going to be right up there. I think that it's going to be the best, most consistent, well-executed first season of a Star Trek series ever.
I know. I want to say it was LA Times. Some reviewer that was doing the whole Comic-Con San Diego gamut
mm-hmm.
made the Star Trek pilot and impression one of the top four or fives of San Diego Comic-Con among all the franchises. So that's a good portent for Discovery. We'll
see. I agree.
David, we'll let you get on with everything, and thanks. I'm glad we found some time here at Trek Vegas.
I'm glad you caught up with me, Larry. It's a pleasure to talk to you.
Glad we got you out west for once, David.
It was great to be here. Thank you for having me.
Thanks a lot. All right.